Welcome to the Infowars Nightly News. I'm David Knight. It's Monday, December 28th, 2015. Here are our top stories.
Tonight, how the surveillance state is hitting the open road. Then, the president of Gun Owners of America on what's ahead for 2016. After that, how terrorism is threatening the First Amendment. And a White House official calls the war on drugs a failure.
Are you saying that the way we have waged the war on drugs for more than 40 years has been all wrong?
It has been all wrong.
That's next.
As the aircraft land at MENA, to this day, C-130s full of cocaine, so heavy they come in hard. The trucks are unloaded, it's shipped into your communities, and you love it. I've interviewed Terry Reed, who was CIA, at the airfield. Saw all of them out there. Just, it was a party. And that's why they keep drugs illegal, so they can put you and your family in prison if you're dumb enough to use it.
Clean, pure drinking water. You can't survive without it. But where do you get it? Alexa Pure Pro is a brand new, groundbreaking, gravity-fed water filtration system that is like no other. The Alexa Pure Pro transforms water from virtually any fresh source into clean, healthy drinking water, pairing the unprecedented superfiltration power of an all-new gravity block core with a hybrid chromatic shell. It removes up to 99.999% of impurities, including bacteria, viruses, fluoride, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. Filter capacity up to 5,000 gallons. Stainless steel construction. Easy assembly. Low maintenance. Replacement filters are simple to install. And now, as part of an exclusive limited time introductory offer, you can save $20 off the retail price and get free shipping. This is a limited time offer, so order your unit today and receive free shipping and $20 off. Go to InfoWarsStore.com or call 888-253-3139.
As we end the year, there are a lot of wars inside. And I'm not talking about just the literal wars that are happening all over the Middle East. Of course, there's a Syrian war that our government has worked to foster, to create, to essentially establish a regime change, to create chaos in the region. Are we going to have a World War III? Is that no-fly zone that they want so desperately to put into Syria? Is that going to be the trigger for a conflict between the U.S. and Russia? But of course, there are some other wars that are just as real. Some of these are metaphorical wars. Some of these have been going on for decades, like the drug war. But of course, there's other ones, like the cyber war. And of course, that is an attack on our internet, on our free speech. It's an attack on our privacy. It's an attack on our ability to be able to move about freely. We got an article, we're going to talk about this in the news today. It's rolling out. First, with commercial traffic. It's also an attack on our ability to engage in commerce and trade without surveillance. That's what the war on cash is about. We've also got some stories about the war of civilizations, the clash of civilizations that's being created deliberately by those in our government and the top of other Western governments. This is a deliberate, orchestrated effort to try to destroy the economy, the culture, and the sovereignty of Western governments. And of course, the tools that they're using to do this are open borders and massive migration. And then at the end of the show tonight, we're going to have an interview with Larry Pratt of Gun Owners of America. We're going to talk about the war on guns, but of course, it's really a war on our constitutional protections, a war on the way that we have always established due process. Are we going to have a star chamber that accuses people in secret and then takes their rights? Are we going to have a government that is essentially run as a dictatorship through executive orders, whether by the president or by bureaucracy? But let's begin first with the cyber war. All of these wars have one thing in common. They want to master the human domain. They want to centralize control. And of course, ultimately, that control is going to be centralized globally. But they all want to control and watch your every movement. Take a look at these new federal rules that are going to be applied to truckers at the beginning of the year. This is something that is coming out of a bureaucracy. It's not coming out of the Congress. No, the Congress doesn't write laws anymore. The laws always come from a bureaucracy. And the Washington Post points out, they take an example of a man named Brian Spoon. They say, for his entire career in truck driving, he's tried to be his own boss. That's exactly what they do not want. They don't want you to have any financial or economic independence. He's a third-generation trucker. He started driving in the military. He bought his own truck back in 2004. First, he leased it to a company. Then he became an independent. But now his freedoms are being taken away. They're being taken away by a new federal regulation. Not a law, but a regulation. He and more than 3 million other drivers have until the end of 2017 to buy and install an electronic logging device that connects his engine and broadcasts his speed and its location to the shipper. Now, understand, this is something that is being done by a paper log right now to the people that they would work with or work for. But this also has direct application to you as an individual. This isn't something that's just going to be used to stop truckers. The Department of Transportation has already mandated devices to be put into your cars. You're going to pay for them, and they are calling them talking cars, vehicle-to-vehicle communication. Of course, what they're going to be talking about is you. They're going to be measuring the same types of stuff that they're measuring with the truckers, logging their location, logging their speed, looking at how they're driving. And of course, that's going to be used to pressure you out of private vehicle ownership in the same way that they're trying to pressure the truckers first out of being independent businessmen. They say this could be the final straw for many truckers who've grown impatient with the new restrictions. The mandate is broadly unpopular since it represents a loss of control. They say the industry is going to lose a whole section of very safe drivers who could work for a few more years but are just going to call it quits. Of course, that's the desire. That's the design. They want them to get out because they're going to replace them with robot trucks. So this is one way to force them out with regulations, just like they're going to force you out of driving your own car. Now, they are going to push back on this, and of course, they have done so in the past. They've pushed back against the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. That's the particular bureaucracy in this case is exerting their control over people's lives. They say the first attempt at doing this, they came back and said, this is going to... doesn't have any measurement in here, anything restricting harassment of drivers by these trucking companies, pushing them in some cases to drive more than the legal limit. And of course, that cuts both ways, but that's not fundamentally the issue. We have to understand where this is really headed. We have to understand the end game, because this is being applied not just to truckers, but as I said, to private individuals, to private car ownership. We look at this article here. Private car ownership is on the road to becoming a rarity. And of course, they're very excited about this, and they hate individuals driving cars. This is something we've seen for a very long time from the socialists, from the people running our government, from the local governments all the way up to the federal government. They want to take away your vehicle. That's an element of freedom for you, but they see it as a tool of control. They can control your movement. It gives them another base where they can build their little bureaucratic empire. And of course, this is a Malthusian view of the car. We just have too many cars. We can't control them. We can't build the roads. And we need to focus everybody into these tiny cities. And we don't want you spread out into the suburbs. So we want to confine you into the cities as part of this Agenda 21, as part of this 2030 agenda that they've just put together. That's what is fundamentally behind this. But they also want to be able to watch and control your every movement. They say that there's an ocean of cars, and policymakers and common folk of life have been powerless against the siren song of the automobile. Well, that is simply a song of freedom, of independence, of being able to go wherever you want to go, whenever you want to go. That has been the fundamental freedom that Americans have celebrated since the middle of the 21st century. They want to take that away. And of course, they offer us a futuristic utopia where all the cars are owned by just one corporation. And of course, they're going to be controlled by the government. The only good news, as we see in California, the DMV there is starting to pull back. They've seen Google cars involved in accident rates that are five times what individual humans have been involved in. And so now they're saying that they're not going to allow these cars operating on the roads unless they have a human driver in them. Nevertheless, we need to understand the push and the pull between corporations and governments to try to set up, again, this kind of fascist crony capitalism that will allow a few elite businessmen to control everything, working with the government so the government will have ultimate control over your movement, watching you everywhere you go. Look at this example out of the UK. Surveillance powers will help to unmask online bullies. As if this is a pressing problem, they're going to take away your privacy on the internet with a sweeping new surveillance powers to unmask anonymous internet bullies and bring them to justice. Was that really a problem that needed to be addressed? Is that a problem that we need to sacrifice our privacy for? They say a new power that will force internet providers to retain web browsing information will help the police to hunt down and identify the most serious cyber bullies and trolls. Pretty amazing. Now, of course, a lot of people see through these phony justifications that the government is using. There's a story from the Washington Post that was linked on the Drudge Report. Techno-skeptics' objections are growing louder, and they talk to a documentary filmmaker and a musician, a political activist. She says she's not paranoid, but she keeps duct tape over the camera lens on her laptop computer, something Alex Jones has been doing for over a decade, probably two decades, because as everyone knows, these gadgets can be taken over by nefarious agents of all kinds. That's the way the Washington Post puts it. Now, of course, that kind of snarky sarcasm is a little bit different. It's one level removed from just scoffing at people and dismissing them as tinfoil hat conspiracy theorists. No, you're not paranoid if they're really watching you. And, you know, the people who are the conspirators are the people who are watching us. And it's typically the government. People are beginning to wake up. This is something that Hugo de Garis talked about in his book, The Arlek Wars. And of course, he was focused on people waking up about artificial intelligence. There's also the aspect of people waking up to surveillance by the government. And of course, they're coming together. The Washington Post tries to make this look like they are idiots, that they're kind of kooks. If you look at the picture that they've got there of a guy with his eyes rolled back playing guitar, they say the powerful definitely do not want us to reboot things. They will go to great lengths to stop us. They will use brute force, or they will use bureaucracy. Now, that's exactly true. The people are saying exactly what is going to happen. And as Hugo de Garis talked about, there would be a group of people who were technologically elite. He called them the cosmists. He said people are going to wake up and see that the technology is running out of control, that is going to run over them. He called those people Terrans. Some people call them Luddites. Nevertheless, we need to do exactly as Donald Trump was talking about with the borders when he said, we want to understand what's happening here. We want to take a look and see what is coming in and then determine what we're going to do about that. That's what these people are saying about technology. And of course, it's they come across and say, well, you want to ban all Muslims or you want to ban all technology. No, we want to understand what's going on. And we also want you to understand that we should have encryption and privacy. That is something that Apple's CEO Tim Cook talked about on CBS's 60 Minutes about a week ago. And of course, there was a massive pushback against that. He's talked about that in the past. He is responding to the disgust that people have about this voyeuristic, paranoid government that wants to monitor and control everything that we do. And so when he's talking about how they're going to put encryption in at a system level, so that when the government demands that they turn over records, they'll turn them over, but they'll be encrypted records. And of course, the government will still be able to decrypt those records. Nevertheless, the government is very angry about that. We immediately got reactions from a Manhattan district attorney. He said, if the government lays a proper warrant on us today, then we will give the specific information that's requested because we have to. In the case of encrypted information, we don't have to give it. That's what Tim Cook said. Of course, this district attorney said, iPhones will now then become the first consumer products in American history beyond the reach of lawful warrants. The result is crimes will go unsolved. Victims will be left beyond the protection of the law. No, they will just have privacy. But then, of course, we have this senator, Senator Tom Cotton, who says it's going to be the preferred messaging system of child pornographers, drug traffickers, and terrorists. That's how they like to portray everybody who wants to have privacy. And I want you to just think about how crazy this desire to monitor and control everything that we have, the incessant desire to know even more about us. Look at how they push back in the latest debate. We actually had people saying that Ted Cruz should be investigated by the Senate Intelligence Committee because he made a minor statement about the monitoring of people. Now, of course, this is part of the debate on counterterrorism. Marco Rubio never saw an espionage program spying on the American public that he didn't want to extend. What Ted Cruz said was, What he knows is that the old program covered 20 to 30% of phone numbers to search for terrorists. The new program covers nearly 100%. That gives us greater ability to stop acts of terrorism, and he knows that's the case. Now, Marco Rubio implied in the debate, he said, let me be very careful when answering this because I don't think national television in front of 15 million people is the place to discuss classified information. You see that? And with that, they touched off a kind of McCarthyistic witch hunt against Ted Cruz. It was shut down within about a day and a half. Nevertheless, there were people saying we need to investigate him because he mentioned some numbers about our super secret program. That's the kind of paranoia we need to push back against. Now, let's take a look at the drug war. This is an old running drug war. But we need to understand how this is coming to us and what it is doing to destroy our society. Look at these two stories real quickly. Now, when we look at the old war on drugs, we just had our drugs czar say it is a complete failure. Nevertheless, like Chris Christie, he wants to continue to prosecute it. He's someone who understands that there's a medical treatment side to it, but he wants to prosecute it. And what we need to look at is how it has totally corrupted our law enforcement, for example. Two stories focusing on that one aspect of the failed war on drugs. This particular one from the Institute of Justice, cops seized over $107,000 from a couple, and they didn't charge them with a crime. These people were speeding, they pull them over, they say a drug dog sniffed and indicated on the car, so then they searched the car and found $107,000. Now, the people say that it was taken from savings and from a disabilities payment. They were on their way to get treatment for their son. Nevertheless, after 3 years, they've not been able to recover that cash. This is yet another case. There's been 62,000 seizures since 9/11 where the police did not use warrants, did not even charge the owners with the crime, but just stole the cash. And of course, it's very prevalent in Illinois where this took place. They said they've received more than $186 million in federal forfeiture. They call it a civil forfeiture because they don't press charges against you. They don't give you your due process. So the fiction of civil asset forfeiture has turned our police into thieves, into literal highway robbers. When we come back, I'm going to tell you how one small town was turned into money launderers in the war on drugs. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
No one will go to the New York Times or care that it's even admitted that the government's hatching most of the terror plots. Or people will say, what are you doing? Endorsing radical Islam, saying it doesn't exist? I didn't say that. I said our criminal government is arming them, aiding and abetting them, protecting them to attack and kill us so they can take our freedoms. That's what I said.
Never water yourself down just because someone can't handle you at 100 proof. It's the Alex Jones Show, because there's a war on for your mind.
CNN, MSNBC, Fox News, Glenn Beck, and everybody else that runs around claiming that I'm saying there aren't any real Muslim terrorists. That's a load of crud, and you know it.
Shane Steiner's involvement with InfoWarsLife.com truly happened in an organic way. I went to high school with Shane, his brother, knew his parents well, and he was visiting the office once, hadn't been to the office in years, and said, wow, I notice you're making and selling supplements. Do these really work? Because I've tried a lot of supplements as a workout enthusiast, and I really think most of them are hype. And I said, here, take some home, try it. Well, a few weeks later, he came in blown away and said, I want to buy 3 boxes of this stuff to give my friends and family. It's simply amazing. He said, why does it work so well? And I said, listen, go to InfoWarsLife.com, watch the informational videos with Dr. Group and others. They understand how it all works. I know that it works for me. That's all I understand. The science, the facts, the research, people's testimonials, they're all on InfoWarsLife.com. You can check it out for yourself.
I wanted to go to the gym. I wanted to push myself and work out harder. And that led to me being able to come out and do stuff like the barefooting and the surfing and stuff like that, which what I would have never done. I never would have done that 2 years ago.
Shane has said over and over again, more than just libido and energy, it made him want to get into the gym more. It made him want to get in better shape. And believe me, the Steiners have amazing genetics. His brother is a world champion steer wrestler. His dad, Bobby Steiner, is a famous world champion bull rider. They've got natural genetics. But when you added this to the mix, in Shane's own words, it took him to the next level. Shane noticed the mental clarity. Bobby was able to work out longer and gain muscle mass. He's already completely shredded. I gotta admit, for me, the biggest effect has been libido. Now, I've never claimed to have a body like some beach model, but back when I was 20, 22 years old and worked out every day, I looked great. But over the years, and being married, having three kids, and working 18 hours a day, I gained basically 100 pounds. And it's been a long process of losing that weight in the last 4 years. But if you look at the photos and the videos of what I looked like 4 or 5 years ago versus today, the results are dramatic. I'd already cleaned up my diet, I was working out hard, but I'd only lost about 20 pounds. It was adding the other key ingredients from InfowarsLife.com that helped me personally go to the next level and shed another 35 pounds.
This has actually made me feel so good that here lately, about a year ago, I started training jiu-jitsu, and that kind of led to doing some boxing and kickboxing. I mean, it's amazing that 2 years ago, I was on the couch and couldn't even tie my shoes, and now I'm training with MMA fighters and just doing stuff that I never thought that I would be doing ever again. So Super Male Vitality has allowed me to do some amazing things. And if it has those kind of effects for me, I know that it will do great things for you. So just try Super Male Vitality. I promise you, you'll love it.
And finally, let's look at Anthony Gucciardi, Infowars.com reporter. He also works with Dr. Group and others, helping develop the newest, most cutting edge, high quality supplements. Let's take a look at what happened when he tried to barefoot ski for the first time with the Steiners. And remember, we're not making fun of him. He had the will to get in the arena, and he's lost more than 10 pounds in the last few years of fat and gained more than 10 pounds of muscle. And Anthony chalks it up to Super Male Vitality as well. Bottom line, folks, you want to discover the power of Super Male Vitality and Super Female Vitality for yourself by visiting InfowarsLife.com today or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139.
Now, in the last segment, we were talking about something that's become a long-term game. This goes back to the 1980s, and of course, that's civil asset forfeiture. But now we see a small-town police force taking this to a completely different level of corruption. This was on the Drudge Report today, talking about the small city of Bal Harbour laundering millions from the small police department in drugs to Caracas, Venezuela, connections to the president there, President Maduro. This village police force broke the law, said a former top DEA agent. They wired drug money to known drug traffickers and money launderers. They say they sent drug money to a well-known trafficker, a cash smuggler, a money launderer, more than $4 million in all. Where does a small-town police department come up with this kind of money? It's absolutely amazing to see the story. They say, in spite of U.S. warnings about the emergence of the country as a major hub for cocaine, that'd be Venezuela, the police never investigated the people to whom they were sending millions in drug proceeds, including a host of individuals with criminal records. They say, it's absurd. You're a Bal Harbour police officer. Your jurisdiction is local, said a former DEA chief from New York. He said, they were just laundering money for the sake of laundering money. Yeah, you know, like HSBC and UBS, these big banks who laundered money. They even gave the Sinaloa cartel their own checkout window, HSBC did. What did they get for that? A very small slap on the wrist, a very small fine. I don't think you're even going to see that happen to this police department. Now, they say among the recipients was a guy named William Amaro, a 48-year-old assistant to President Maduro, a longtime friend of his. He got $45,000 on one day. The next day, they did it again. He got $37,000. Four more times, the cops sent money to his account, $250,000 nearly in all. And as I pointed out before, that was $4 million. They say, making the payments all the more remarkable, the U.S. government was then conducting investigations into the Venezuelan government leaders' involvement in the drug trade, especially the criminal groups using the nation as a shipping point. They say U.S. studies show that 24% of cocaine produced in South America channeled through that company. Now, here's the bottom line. This is an undercover sting operation run by a tiny, small police department in Bal Harbour, small town. It generated millions of dollars, however, for that police task force, and they never made a single arrest. Of course, they got the money. As one lawyer in South Florida said, I can't think of a more podunk town than Bal Harbour. Not in a bad way, but in the sense that these cops would have otherwise been stopping traffic and shooting radar, as if we really need them to do that. He says, in reality, they were being money launderers. The minute they started doing busts, it would have been all over. But of course, it wasn't. It was simply about corrupting the police. And that's what we've seen with the war on drugs, the failed war on drugs. Understand, it's not getting anybody off of drug addiction. Now, there's another war that's developing, of course, and that's the one in the presidential campaign. This war is shaping up between Clinton and Trump. And as part of that, we see Hillary attacking Trump on the so-called war on women. Here's a clip.
What he said yesterday about you, does that have to do with your gender? Is that part of what's going on?
He thrives on that kind of exchange. I think he has to answer for what he says, and I assume that, others will, make the larger point about his language. It's not the first time he's demonstrated a penchant for sexism.
Now joining me now is Leanne McAdoo. And of course, Leanne, Trump wasted no time in firing back at Hillary Clinton, yeah, by reminding her that she's throwing stones in a glass house.
Yeah, exactly. Now, we knew that the Democratic Party was going to be using this war on women because, of course, Hillary would be their front runner. But I don't think that the DNC expected to be going up against a candidate that has absolutely no filter. So he tweeted this out on December 26th. He says, Hillary Clinton has announced that she is letting her husband out to campaign, but he's demonstrated a penchant for sexism. So inappropriate. So he's basically saying, look, be careful, because if you want to go there, I'm going to go there with you, Hillary. And, it's just interesting to see that now they're establishment media, the DNC, they're having to deal with this sort of firecracker that they weren't expecting. And so let's take a look at how the DNC is framing this story. Here is the DNC chair, Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
Donald Trump or any candidate on the other side of the aisle would raise Bill Clinton as somehow a negative to their peril. I think every poll I've ever seen shows that if President Clinton were a candidate tomorrow, he'd be reelected. He presided at that time over the longest period of prosperity sustained up to that point, finished his term very popular, and continues to be one of the most admired elected officials and former elected officials and men in the world.
So yeah, Debbie Wasserman Schill, as I like to call her. She's warning people off of criticizing Clinton.
Yeah, well, and she's also basically saying it's okay to sexually assault people. You'll still be revered in their party. But that's not it. This one is major. So this is CNN asking this question. They want to know, is Bill Clinton sexist, or does he simply just like women?
We set the record straight. Is Bill Clinton sexist, or does he simply like women? He had so many high-powered women in his cabinet, everybody from, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who he appointed to the Supreme Court, but then he had Attorney General Janet Reno, Secretary of State Madeleine Albright, Donna Shalala. So is he sexist? Is that a fair...
So I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that, he probably didn't want to hook up with Janet Reno, okay? So they're pointing out all of these women that he had in his cabinet, and, that's not sexist. How is that? They're not talking about the sexual assaults.
I'm not talking about the women under his desk. And that's the issue, You talk about the cabinet women and everything, but this is far beyond sexism. This is about sexual assault. I mean, that is way beyond just having a condescending attitude towards women.
No, absolutely. And this is why now Breitbart, John Nolte at Breitbart points out that this is the smoking gun. The GOP establishment cannot beat Hillary Clinton, period. And he points out how Anna Navarro, who is a confidant of Jeb Bush, she's very much part of the GOP establishment. She was on CNN speaking with the anchor there, and the anchor said, Anna, the war on women argument has worked against Republicans in the past. Do you think that this is, the best defense using Bill Clinton? And she basically sort of laughs it off, and she's like, no, leave it alone. If Hillary and Bill can work it through their marriage and get it all worked out, that's their business, not ours. But this has nothing to do with Hillary or Bill Clinton. This is someone that has a repeated record of sexual assault. disrespecting women, taking advantage of young interns, things like that. And so here we have the establishment media once again determining that certain things are off limits. You can't talk about, we saw this with Obama, how you weren't allowed to talk about Reverend Wright, Bill Ayers, Tony Resco, the hidden records, Benghazi. These are things you're not allowed to talk about. And so obviously the sexual assaults with Bill Clinton, they say it's off limits because he's revered. And he even won an award from, like, you know, his great work with women. And
of course, you've got this double standard. I mean, when they were trying to balance the budget, Newt Gingrich came up with cuts. They called him the Gingrich who stole Christmas. And yet when the budget did get balanced, largely due to the bubble economy that the Federal Reserve was creating, Bill Clinton got all the credit for that. So, you have this interesting set of double standards that they play by, and Donald Trump is not going to play by that standard.
Right, absolutely. And, you know, the fact that they made such a big deal that Trump used the word schlonged, okay, which people can see that that's a term that is used in, it's kind of a Yiddish term, it's used. But the establishment media was using the term teabagging and calling these people teabaggers as if that wasn't an offensive term. That's totally okay to bring that into the political lexicon. But, you know, don't say schlonged if you're talking
about Hillary Clinton. And that doesn't have any other context other than a scatological one.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Yeah. No, so that's something that you can't. And then, of course, you know, we have, it's not just people like Donald Trump. Of course, Rand Paul also brought this up, saying that the Democrats, how dare they talk about the war on women when the media has always covered up Bill Clinton's sexual assaults. But also, too, Hillary Clinton was the one who first called all of these women coming after Bill bimbos.
Yeah.
And she was calling this the bimbo eruptions in the 90s. So these women have come out and said that, you know, shame on you. Hillary wrote the book on terrorizing women, and it's a joke that she would run on women's issues. So these are the women who were actually victimized by Bill Clinton. And so absolutely this should be brought up within this election cycle. It's very important. This is someone that's going to be in the White House.
Yeah. Well, of course, it's not just the war on women, but of course the Democrats, as well as the Republican establishment, has been involved in a war on the working class. And I think that's what they're really worried about.
Yeah.
Those people see how they've been eviscerated under the bipartisan policies. And the only person who is really pushing back against that is Donald Trump. And that's what they're really worried about, because that's something that's going to break down. It's going to be like the Reagan Democrats, I think, and when this comes to the general election. Thank you very much, Leanne. And when we come back, we're going to have some special reports and then an interview with Larry Pratt of Gun Owners of America, talking about what's ahead in the coming year, the attacks on our freedom, the attacks on our legal system.
You guys have the exclusive for, which is a product called Deep Cleanse. And why I'm so excited about it is it's a unique formula, almost like the iodine crystals. We have two unique products that nobody in the world has. One of the most amazing ingredients in the world, and it's called Shilajit, and it's actually known as blood of the mountain or rock sweat, because thousands of years ago, as a matter of fact, this ingredient was only given to the elite of the elite. Thousands of years ago, up in the Himalayan mountains and in Tibet.
And we wanted to put this in stuff for a couple years, but we couldn't get an organic form.
Right. I mean,
so let's explain. I mean, this stuff's so good, we couldn't put it out for years.
Right. So I had to actually, it's kind of like the iodine crystals, finding a source deep in the earth that we could get the cleanest source available. But in Tibet and in Nepal and in the Himalayan mountains, thousands of years ago, they watched these monkeys. And during the summer months, the monkeys would go up into the mountains.
Now you're being racist against monkeys.
And they would pick this black substance from the mountains. And so in Russia, they actually, it grows in Russia in the mountains and in the Himalayas and only in the summer. And Shilajit is actually the decomposition of up to 7,000 different medicinal herbs. So it decomposes, all these different herbs decompose in the Himalayan mountains and the volcanic soil up there. And what happens in the summertime.
So it's almost like an oil from.
Yes, it's high in fulvic acid, it's high in humic acid.
Because they're always claiming oil is really from decomposed animals and plants. There is some oil that is based from fossils, but most of it's really abiotic. But so this is a true fossil source? I mean, explain it to me.
It is it's really the decomposition, like I said, of over 7,000 different medicinal herbs and plants. And with the rocks and the pressure deep in the mountains, it freezes And during the summertime and the pressures build it up,
it oozes out.
So it literally oozes out of the mountain.
It's like rock sap.
It's black and it's highly nutritious. Even in the 1980s, when the Olympic athletes in Russia were accused of being on steroids, they found out that they were actually been given Shilajit because it works as an anabolic as well, and it builds muscles. It's a big dose in there. The second big main ingredient in there is a volcanic zeolite concentrate. And what this formula is designed to do, the Shilajit and the zeolites have a real strong negative charge. All the metals and chemicals and PCBs and VOCs have positive charges. So these go in, they grab it, and then they safely eliminate it through the body so you can become healthy. I mean, this is an amazing formula. I wish I actually had it, but because this was an exclusive InfoWars Life product, you're the only one in the world that has this formula now. And, you know, there is going to be a limited supply available when you sell out because you can only harvest this once a year.
How do people take it? How is it recommended that this be done? Just a daily dose?
Yeah, daily dose. The instructions are on the label. You know, of course, I kind of modify it for each individual. It depends on what your lifestyle is. I mean, honestly, the best thing to do is for you to avoid all these chemicals and toxins in your environment and try to identify them and start slowly reducing them. But personally, I'm going to probably take it every day, every other day, and I'll probably go with about a dropper full to maybe two dropper fulls. I don't expose myself to any chemicals.
InfoWarsLife.com. Please also support our local AM and FM affiliates. Support their local sponsors or become a sponsor and spread the word. Because these aren't just great products. This is how we fund this independent operation. We're not taxpayer funded like MSNBC or NPR, and neither is your local station. So support them, folks. This is a war.
The use of TSA body scanners has been a very controversial topic, with privacy advocates stating that the machines show too much of one's person, health advocates and pregnant mothers concerned about the effects the machines can have on unborn children, citing how x-ray technicians use lead walls before they operate similar types of machinery. With all this in mind, the TSA has quietly phased out or is phasing out the opt-out option, stating how they can strongly suggest that somebody go through the machine as opposed to getting a pat down. So we're going to ask the people out here what they think about the new change in policy. Oh, excuse me, sir. We're asking people what they think about the TSA change in policy eliminating the pat down option.
I have not heard about that.
Oh. Well, I didn't have to go through security this morning, but you did. I think it's fine.
Yeah.
I think as long as they still do a thorough check, then it shouldn't be a problem for anybody.
I actually go through some of the pre lines, so I don't have that deal. So not worry about it.
I do pre also because I come here too much.
Well, some people are concerned. You see pregnant mothers and health advocates, mm-hmm. They're concerned about the effects the machines can have on things such as unborn children.
Well, okay, so you're talking about eliminating the ability to do a pat down in lieu of the scanner? Oh, no, I think they need to keep it for that.
Well, some people concerned, such as pregnant mothers and health advocates, they're worried about the effects that the body scanners could have on unborn children.
That's true. I didn't think about that.
I mean, from what I've heard and what I've seen online and so forth, is the radiation is really minimal. So I personally think if that's something that you're worried about, probably should figure out a different way to get to where you're going.
Well, I'm glad they're doing that. I don't like being patted at all. Well, pet somebody else, okay?
Well, I agree with you on that one.
I got patted down.
What'd you think about it?
It was very traumatic for me.
What would you think about your wife going through if she was pregnant?
Well, I'm sure there's probably needs to be more research to find out if it actually happens or not.
It's interesting to note that the shining example for why body scanners are used in the first place is the underwear bomber, a person who was allowed through the security checkpoint many years ago. Meanwhile, a man was able to transport a pistol through security just this year. Also, even though the TSA has yet to stop a single terrorist attack, we saw the state of Texas threatened with a no-fly zone when they sought to oust the agency. And finally, activist John Corbett, who was previously censored by the TSA for posting documents that they themselves released, is suing the agency over the pat-down rule change.
And there you have it. More reports at InfoWars.com.
The ghetto, not the place you would imagine methods of global dominance to spring from. But it was in the ghettos across the United States that Saul Alinsky would fine-tune tactics of civil disobedience that would one day be employed by New World Order puppet Barack Hussein Obama.
Resolutions of ideal problems always carry within their wake another problem.
Alinsky's Rules for Radicals is the left's playbook, chock full of creeping tactics used by scheming politicians and Soros-fueled millennial generation groups like Black Lives Matter. Hell-bent on tearing the fabric of American society apart.
The anti-cop rhetoric that is sweeping the United States of America, fueled by this group, some of the vulgar, vile, vicious rhetoric that's coming out, talking about killing cops.
Alinsky's albeit deceptively noble attempt to create a system to reward the have-nots with the power and surplus of the haves would prove to be just as useful for the New World Order sycophants to achieve an uprooting of American values and an overpass of the United States constitutional foundation to be replaced by totalitarianism disguised as compassionate socialism. These tactics simply needed the perfect charismatic turncoat to steer them. Enter Barack Obama.
All of us want to give our president every tool necessary to do this. And all of us were willing to do that in this bill. And anyone who says otherwise is lying to the American people.
Saul Alinsky died decades before a young pre-Senate Barack Obama would spend 3 years following in Alinsky's footsteps as a community organizer. In 2009, the National Review stated, Obama's mentors from his Chicago days studied at a school Alinsky founded, and they taught their students the philosophy and methods of one of the first community organizers. Saul Alinsky wrote in Rules for Radicals, as an organizer, I start from where the world is, as it is, not as I would like it to be. That we accept the world as it is doesn't in any sense weaken our desire to change it into what we believe it should be. It is necessary to begin where the world is if we are going to change it to what we think it should be. That means working in the system. So what are some of the tactics being utilized in that system at accelerating degrees in the shaping of modern American society? Rule number one, power is not only what you have, but what the enemy thinks you have. Obama and the nutjobs in the nation's capital would have us all believe that they have overwhelming support from the have-nots, while destroying the middle class, increasing the debt and welfare class to unsustainable levels, and projecting it all from their mainstream media bubble. Rule number two, never go outside the expertise of your people. Basically, why bother engaging in a rational debate based on facts with your adversary? Simply bring up the despised policies or traditions and belittle them until they are crushed.
Less than loving expressions by Christians? Well, I get concerned.
That's right. Let's criticize Christianity on Easter, you piece of crap.
That's topic for another day.
Skipping to rule number eight, keep the pressure on. Never let up. Obama must say this rule to himself every morning. As one shoe drops, another one is ready to fall. Not in the manner of a leader responding to a country's pleas in the midst of a crisis, but more in the vein of a tyrant, quietly and charismatically creating them, while offering shallow direction as stale as his predecessor's rhetoric. And if just that sample of Saul Alinsky's Rules for Radicals wasn't enough, Alinsky even dedicated the left's playbook to Lucifer himself.
I suppose, given a choice, I think I would pick hell. The reason I'd pick hell is because that's where all the have-nots are.
John Bound for Infowars.com.
As a community moves towards despotism, respect is restricted to fewer people.
That's veteran Denver police officer Charles Jones IV smashing an unarmed suspect in the face six times.
Officers accused of using excessive force on a suspect and then trying to erase the evidence.
I'm observing what they're doing in there.
Don't take me. I don't understand what's going on.
A community rates low on an information scale when the press, radio, and other channels of communication are controlled by only a few people.
Does it raise ethical questions about the use of government money to produce stories about the government that wind up being aired with no disclosure that they were produced by the government?
How can you ask such a question?
What difference at this point does it make?
When a competent observer looks for signs of despotism in the community, he looks beyond fine words and noble phrases.
There are actions I have the legal authority to take as president that will help make our immigration system more fair and more just. Tonight, I'm announcing those actions.
What I say goes, see? I'm the law around here.
He came, he saw, he died.
Yes, in modern warfare, our military leaders are finding that words and ideas are highly effective weapons.
We just have to be repetitive about this. We need to do this every day of the week and just really brainwash people into thinking about guns in a vastly different way.
We are trained to deceive if we have to. You really don't have to trust me. You shouldn't trust me. In fact, by my actually participating in that, I will taint the news.
In communities of this kind, despotism stands a good chance.
The nine most terrifying words in the English language are, I'm from the government and I'm here to help.
How can this youth? Well, we're going to do everything we can to help you.
Resistance to tyrants is obedience to God. It's the Alex Jones Show, because there is a war on for your mind.
Brain Force is here. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been on this the last few months. You probably noticed I've been more crazed, more focused, less brain fog, more energy, more special reports, and it's because of Brain Force.
One of the worst things with most energy products is it's not sustainable, right? You're gonna crash and gonna feel really bad afterwards. This has a bunch of different antioxidants and compounds and polyphenols.
Everybody's on these drugs to knock their brain out because the brain's so fried.
We kept changing this formula over and over and over again until it became sort of a grand puzzle. For example, the L-theanine inside of it, that is activated by the different compounds in the yerba mate that we put inside of it as well. This just increases the compounds you already have.
This is what you're actually designed to run on.
Exactly.
It's kind of like a car will run on one form of junkie gas, but it runs really good on what it's designed for.
You will find Brain Force, Survival Shield X2, and other game-changing products at InfoWarsLife.com. Or call 888-253-3139. Introducing Secret 12, the new InfoWars Life vitamin B12 formulation. Most forms of vitamin B12 are highly processed and synthetic and could not be properly absorbed by the body. That's why for real results, so many are having to turn to painful B12 injections, which are known to have higher absorption rates. Now, InfoWarsLife.com is excited to announce that we can bring you our most bioactive, powerful form of B12 that has been developed with our exclusive perfected process. Secret 12 is a binary of nutraceutical grade, bioavailable coenzyme forms of B12, methylcobalamin, the same kind used in B12 injections, and adenosylcobalamin. Secret 12 is simply taken by mouth, right on the tongue, and then swallowed. No needles, no injections. Don't take my word for it. Try it for yourself. Discover the secret. Secret 12. Secure your revolutionary Secret 12 formula right now at InfoWarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
Now, as I mentioned earlier in the program, there is a war on the Constitution, and you need to understand it this way. It's not simply a gun control action that's going to be pushed by Obama. That's the way it's going to be sold to the public. And of course, this is the one part of Obama's agenda that he really hasn't been able to enact yet. So it's going to be a full-on push this year. Joining us now to talk about this and the fact that it is a war on the Constitution, it is a war on due process, is Larry Pratt from Gun Owners of America, tirelessly working for a long time, no stranger to the viewers of this program, tirelessly working to protect our individual liberties. And they have a couple of legal actions that they're taking against some of the actions that Obama has proposed, as well as some others in Congress and elsewhere. So joining us now is Larry Pratt. Welcome, Larry.
Good to be with you. Thank you so much for having me.
Well, thank you so much. And I want to talk about these different actions that you've got coming up here. Of course, the first one is a response to what we've seen the gun control people pushing And that is to say, this is outrageous. And I've seen this pushed on Fox News as well. It's outrageous that people who are on a no-fly list can buy a gun. And yet when we look at their very figures, we know that 91% of the people who have been vetted by the FBI who were on the no-fly list had nothing on them that would keep them from owning a gun. So the question isn't really so much the fact that these people are automatically terrorists because they're on a secret list, but should they even be on that list in the first place? And should a secret list be used to deprive people of their fundamental rights?
Perhaps one way to illustrate just how unreliable, to use a mild word, useless this list is, consider that Ted Kennedy was once on the no-fly list. Now, there's a lot of lists I would have put Ted Kennedy on, and as a talk show host said here in Washington, maybe he should have been on the no-drive list, but no-fly list? Let's get real. That was such an embarrassment. He finally was able to get his name off. That was Senator Kennedy, a really big guy in his day, and it was very difficult for him to get his name off. What do you think it would be for the rest of us if we inadvertently end up, God help us if our name is Robert S. Jones or something like that, where there are many other people with the same name and initial?
And you filed an action, part of a class action lawsuit, Gun Owners of America is part of this. And I think that's the key thing that we need to understand, because I've talked to people who've been put on the no-fly list without any explanation. They didn't know it until they got stranded. One particular case, guy was stranded in Hawaii. They let him fly the first leg of the plane, his journey, and then would not allow him to leave Hawaii. But the thing that really concerns me, and I think the thing that should concern people, even if they don't like the Second Amendment, people who want to have due process, who don't want to live in some kind of a star chamber existence where we have dictates from the executive, where we have a star chamber process where an anonymous accuser can get you put on a secret list, and then based on that, where you have absolutely no recourse against that, you have no open process and trial, against that, they can deprive you of your rights, of your liberties.
It sounds more like the Soviet Union or Nazi Germany. Certainly doesn't sound like constitutional government here in the United States. This is just so completely out of keeping with our form of government, and it's time we get rid of this, and that if law enforcement wants to put somebody on a no-fly list or a no-gun-buy list or a no-this-or-that list, go to court.
Yes.
Use due process. And then I'm fine, and I think everybody else would be as well.
Yes, yes, exactly. That's why we have the Sixth Amendment. Instead of having anonymous accusations of things, there was a thing called the Star Chamber, and it was a direct response of the Star Chamber saying, you're going to accuse people publicly, you're going to give them a day in court publicly where they will have a jury trial, where they can confront their accusers, where they can call witnesses in their defense, where they can have a defense attorney. All of that is destroyed, and the people who want to take guns so badly that they would destroy this is absolutely insane to me.
Well, they've got quite a nice little tool, and it seems to me it's not likely to stop unless the members of Congress hear from the people, and they're going to have to hear from them loud and clear, because Congress has shown over many recent months that they're not all that responsive. They're pretty much in a world of their own here in Washington, and we're going to have to put the hammer down, and it may take a few more defeats of people like Eric Cantor, John Boehner. And after a while, if they don't get the message, there'll be a number of them that just don't come back anymore.
Yeah, that's true. And of course, what we've seen is an abdication of power by the Congress to the executive, who then operates as a dictator in conjunction with these bureaucracies who just put out their mandates and their edicts without any oversight. And of course, writing their own laws. Let's talk about the other case where you filed an amicus brief, and this is in the case of U.S. Versus Watson. Do you want to break that down for us?
Well, Mr. Watson was not able to buy a machine gun. Very few people in the United States are, and you could just forget about it flat out if you want to buy one that was made after 1986. That's wrong in and of itself. It's actually a bad idea that Americans cannot buy machine guns without a ton of paperwork and background checks that go beyond the regular gun purchase. And it's all the more embarrassing when you think that The machine gun is not that kind of big deal. In Norway, when people buy guns, they're encouraged to buy a silencer. And yet here in the United States, silencer is treated as just as much a boogeyman as the machine gun.
Yes, yes.
We're on the wrong track. We've let the government tell we the people what kind of arms we're going to use in order to keep the government under control. The whole reason of the Second Amendment was just that. We have arms because of government.
I want to get a couple of these other issues in and get your response to them quickly. Of course, it's a process of infringement, isn't it, Larry? And that's exactly what Obama plans to do with his executive order. He's now coming after the so-called gun show loophole, which would essentially outlaw all private transfers of firearms. And he's saying he's going to do that by executive order at the beginning of the year.
Well, let me say right now that if the president decides to do something as unlawful and unconstitutional as an action against the purchase and sale of guns that is nowhere provided for in the Constitution or the law of the land, then you're looking at a guy right now that plans to, maybe even on your show, transact with another person in my state. So that's not an issue under federal law. But I've got some guns that I might want to sell, and he might have some guns that he wants to sell that I want to buy. And we're going to do business in contravention of that law.
There you go.
Come and get me.
Excellent. Excellent. Now, one last thing I want to get your response on. That was at the end of last week, by the middle of last week, the Virginia Attorney General, Mark R. Herring, and I've said that I don't know what the R stands for. It should be Red Herring. But of course, he said that he's going to take away the not going to respect the concealed carry permits from people coming from 25 different states. He says they're too lax. And yet one of the states, Kentucky, that he's going to take the recognition away from, they do background checks on a monthly basis. Your response to that?
Well, Mr. Herring is obviously looking for any area that he can find to make gun control stricter and more difficult and more unconstitutional than it already is. And I can guarantee him that he's going to find his money bag has a hole in it. The legislature is going to be cutting off his funds for that kind of activity. And if he continues, go right ahead, Mr. Herring. You're going to find yourself sitting in an empty office, perhaps, with not even a table to sit in front of.
That'd be great. Now, I've had some people, when I reported on this, came back and said, perhaps this is a direct response to the president of Liberty University, Jerry Falwell Jr., saying that he would like for his students to carry concealed because, of course, there's going to be a lot of students that might be coming to that university coming from states where they already have a concealed carry permit. Is this, you think this is a direct attack against them?
Well, I'm sure that's the one very likely target. Jerry Falwell is not right up there among the most popular with the likes of people like Mr. Herring and the governor of the state of Virginia. But, you know, personal animus is not the reason why laws are supposed to be made.
Yes.
And he's made a law. He's not a lawmaker, but he's made a law anyway. And I'm looking forward to the confrontation because I think he's going to come out of this with a haircut.
Great, great. Thank you so much, Larry Pratt, Gun Owners of America. I look forward to seeing what's coming up in the new year. It's going to be a fight, and I know you're going to be at the front of it. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for what you're doing.
Thanks for shining some light on this. Appreciate it.
Thank you. And as Kurt Russell said, now is not a good time to lay down your weapons. How will you protect yourself? Well, one way that you can protect yourself is to join us every night on the nightly news. Be part of the InfoWar. Join us again tomorrow night at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
Knockout is back. If you want a product that has 10 known ingredients that naturally get your body to relax, your brain to relax, so you get deep, restful sleep, Knockout's it. InfoWarsLife.com. L-theanine, hops flower extract, lemon balm extract, valerian root extract, chamomile flower extract, L-tryptophan extract, melatonin, and more. All organic, all the natural sources. It's the same price as leading brands of melatonin that are 3 milligrams apiece. It has 3 milligrams, the standard recommended dose for an adult. It's got the GABA. So it would probably cost $50 to take all this as separate pills. It's $19.95. You take one or two of these, and it just is really clean, restful sleep is what the reviews are. It's what I've experienced.
and it just synergistically puts everything in there. InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Or call 888-253-3139.
You are watching the InfoWars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfoWarsNews.com. And your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.